Good evening, everyone, and thank you for logging in today's online teaching session on behalf of the Pediatric Hematology Oncology Chapter of India. I welcome you again today. It's indeed a privilege and honor for us to have Dr. Sandeep Agarwala here today, who is going to be discussing Wilms' tumor, the different aspects, including risk stratification surgery, and also some nuts and bolts of Wilms' tumor. Sir doesn't need any introduction to this audience. We have heard sir in various forums. He has been a great support to many of us, not only in academic meetings, but also day-to-day clinical questions, which have been helping us with. Sir is a professor of pediatric surgery and one of the stalwarts of pediatric oncosurgery in India. Sir is at AIIMS Delhi and has had immense contribution in pediatric oncology surgery in India with the number of publications as well as the contribution sir has made in basically getting PHO chapter as well as the Surgical Oncological Society together. So sir is going to be talking on the Wilms' tumor today. It's a longish session, so I think we'll prefer that in between. If you have any questions, post them, and we can interrupt sir in between and clear some doubts while we go along. I also request all of you, as you all know, this is a session which has been supported by ECHO. ECHO have been giving us platform to conduct these sessions for more than a year now. And they have made two observations which I've been requesting you for the last almost a year now every week, and that is please keep your videos on because that's one of the requirements. And also there's feedback which is shared with you before and after the session. Please share the feedback with us because that's also a requirement from their point of view and also important for us to improvise and improve in the next sessions to come. One of the observations which we had after changing the timings to 6 o'clock is that attendance has been a little bit on a lower side. Although I see 75 people already logged in today, I think that probably the credit goes to Dr. Sandeep Agarwala being the speaker, but we have seen the attendance coming down a little bit the last few weeks because some people have made observations that 6 p.m. is not working for them. So please put this feedback. If you have to go back to 4 o'clock session, we can do that. But that will be only possible when you write to us and give the feedback. So with that little introduction, so I request you, sir, to start your presentation, and thank you again taking your time out today amongst your busy schedule, sir. Thank you very much. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Sunil, and I again thank the PHO chapter for having invited me for this discussion, and I would like it to be a discussion with a lot of questions, and I'll cut the frills and just talk the, as Sunil said, nuts and bolts about risk stratification and surgery. The problem with this talk is that a lot of us in India are using different kind of protocols. One, some of us use SIO and some use the COG protocol. I would touch upon both the protocols and both the risk stratification and point out the slight differences which there are. And both are very good things to follow. And you can follow whatever is being followed at your institution and what you feel comfortable with. So even in the risk stratification and in the surgical portion, I will touch upon the nuances in both the protocols. And the first section of the talk will be on the risk stratification, which will be followed by the surgery. And in surgery, we'll take various aspects as I will highlight. Which is important for us to understand. So, my screen doesn't seem to be moving. Let me see. Okay. So, as we all know, it is the Wilms' tumor is the second most common extracranial solid tumor, and it is the common pediatric renal tumor, about 90%, slightly less. The other tumors that we know of are clear cell sarcomas, rhabdoid tumor of the kidney, renal carcinoma, renal cell carcinoma, and a few others like PNET and germ cell tumors and all. And actually, the clear cell sarcomas and rhabdoid tumors are not included within Wilms' tumor. They are separate, but most of the protocols are now including them not as Wilms' tumor, but something on which treatment has been advised and data is being maintained. And this is a tumor of small children. Majority are in less than 3 years age group. So as we all again know, that basically there are two basic concepts that are being followed in the world. One is the SIOP concept, which is mainly in Europe and other countries which follow the SIOP, in which preoperative chemotherapy is given to all patients, followed by surgery. At that point of time, the staging is done and further adjuvant chemotherapy and or radiotherapy is administered as per the stage and the risk stratification. While in the Americas, the COG is most commonly followed, which believes in doing upfront surgery, except for a few exceptions. And at that point of time, before surgery only, based on the radiology and the surgical findings, the histology, the stage is determined, and then the adjuvant chemotherapy and radiotherapy is given. So it is not that the COG is not doing preoperative chemotherapy. There are indications for preoperative chemotherapy in the COG also. And a lot of us in India do a mix and match. And like at AIMS, we follow the COG protocol, but we follow the SIOP philosophy. So because our tumors are large, so we do give preoperative chemotherapy to a large proportion of our patients, nearly 75 to 80% of our patients. But the protocol that we follow, the chemotherapy protocol, is the COG protocol. So within the COG protocol, we have found a place to give this new adjuvant chemotherapy and how we then continue with that. So it's the SIOP philosophy of preoperative chemotherapy because of its advantages, especially in a country like ours, where the patients come late with large tumors and following the COG protocol. But then I know many centers which are following the SIOP chemotherapy protocol, and we'll see how the two are nearly similar, but still slightly different. So I'm not going to talk too much about staging. There's only one or two slides on staging, which are basically similar in both the COG and SIOP protocols, except a small bit of differences here and there. For example, the main difference in the COG staging is that any patient who gets preoperative chemotherapy for any reason is staged as minimum stage 3. So either they are metastatic or bilateral when they are called stage 4 or 5. Otherwise, they will be minimum stage 3 and they will be treated like stage 3, which means 3 drugs and plaque radiotherapy. While SIOP, as we all know, gives preoperative chemotherapy to nearly all the patients except a few age bar, and they would downstage the patient according to the staging at that point of time when the patient is operated. Most in both in SIOP and COG, a biopsy is contraindicated, an open biopsy, because it makes it stage 3. The COG protocol says that even a needle, core needle biopsy will upstage it to stage 2. While in the SIOP, a core needle biopsy does not upstage the tumor and it still remains stage 1 or whatever the staging is after the preoperative chemotherapy. So these are small differences. Otherwise, most of the other things are similar now, at least in the umbrella protocol of the SIOP. Because in the previously in SIOP 2001 staging protocol, there was a stage called stage 2N+. That was a stage in which the hilar lymph nodes were positive. They would stage it at stage 2. But then realizing that the results of this group of patients had a high recurrence rate, they now have included all lymph node positive into stage 3. So that is now nearly similar as the COG staging. So in the COG staging, basically the NWTS-5 staging is followed. And as I said, all pre-nephrectomy chemotherapy patients were considered stage 3. For stage 4, what is new in the COG is that they differentiate the metastatic sites to the pulmonary only metastasis and other metastasis. And for pulmonary only metastasis, there's a different kind of a protocol, which is risk stratification and protocol, which is being followed. The other important difference in the risk stratification of COG and SIOP is the use of biological markers. While the SIOP is using the response to chemotherapy, the histological response to chemotherapy as a very important component of their risk stratification, the COG has used the loss of heterozygosity at 1p and 16q as a very important parameter, besides the histology, where they believe the histology as favorable or anaplastic. So within this, they try to do a risk stratification. We'll see how the risk stratification varies. So first I'll talk about the risk stratification basically in the COG protocol and then in the SIOP protocol. So in the COG protocol, in the pathology for Wilms tumor, they have favorable histology and they have unfavorable histology, which is basically anaplastic disease, focal or diffuse. And other histologies, as I said, are not considered Wilms tumor, but they are still accounted for and chemotherapy advised and data maintained. And clear cell sarcoma is the next most common, then the rhabdoid tumor in the kidney. And RCC is not, again, is data is collected, but not counted as Wilms tumor. In the children, it is quite common. In the older children, it becomes a more important thing to worry about. In the outcomes of NWTS-5 study, which was basically looking at the biological studies, showed us the importance of loss of heterozygosity at 1P and 16Q, both. So the loss of heterozygosity at both sites have to be present to count for use in the risk stratification. And they found that the event-free survival and overall survival was differing in patients who had this loss of heterozygosity. And on the basis of this NWTS-5 study, the COG studies from 2007 to 2013 were planned, and that the, most of the data for this is available. The data was frozen in 2016, and from 2018 onwards, a lot of results have come out for this. So they found that the loss of heterozygosity at 16q was present in 20% of Wilms tumor, at 1p in 11%. Combined 1p and 16q is about 7 to 10%. So 7 to 10% of the patients are going to be biologically poor because of this marker. And the adverse prognosis is if both loss of heterozygosity is present in all stages except for the very low risk group. I will explain what this very low risk group is in the COG studies. The 5-year event-free survival was 70% versus 84%, and the overall survival 89% versus 95% if the LOH was present, the survivors were poor. So then the stage 4, metastatic disease, again dealt with quite differently in COG and in SIO. In COG, they have defined the response of the metastatic disease, lung-only metastasis. All other metastases are considered as poor risk staging, poor risk stratification, and treated accordingly. For the pulmonary metastasis, they have defined the response on the chemotherapy, and the response is assessed at 6 weeks of chemotherapy. Whether upfront surgery is done or 6 weeks of preoperative chemotherapy is given, it doesn't matter. Complete response is complete response of lung lesions radiologically, and incomplete response when something is left, or stable disease. Now, if a couple of nodules are left in the lung and the surgeon resects those nodules, if and achieves a CR, those nodules, if they are positive, then the COG still considers them as incomplete response, while SIOP will consider them as a good parameter and they have achieved CR. So the CR has to be on radiology. But if the nodules are biopsied and those nodules come out to be negative for tumor, then the COG will stage them as CR for pulmonary metastasis, and we'll see how it makes a difference. So pulmonary response is very important, and this is assessed at 6 weeks, because on this will depend the upgrading of the chemotherapy to regime M and whether lung radiation is provided or not provided. So the rate of response of pulmonary metastasis, they call rapid responders, those who achieve a CR at 6 weeks, and slow responders who are either incomplete response or stable disease. So this is based on CT chest. So CR achieved by resection of a viable nodule is not considered a CR. In COG, it will still be considered as incomplete response. And as I said, in the SIO, at this point of time, if the lung nodules or metastatic disease, wherever there are, if they are resected and the patients achieve a CR, they are, you know, risk stratified differently. So the risk stratification in the COG has these four risk categories: the very low risk, low risk, standard risk, and high risk. So very low risk is a special group in which we have favored, this is risk stratification of favorable histology Wilms tumor. So stage 1, less than 2 years old and 550 grams weight. So this they call as very low risk tumors. And in these patients, they feel that no adjuvant chemotherapy is required. In the low risk is stage 1 or 2 who do not have this loss of heterozygosity. Well, if there is a loss of heterozygosity in any stage, it goes on to the next risk stratification. So stage 1 and 2, if they have a loss of heterozygosity, they become standard risk, while stage 3 with no loss of heterozygosity is standard risk, and stage 4, again with no loss of heterozygosity, who are rapid responders for the pulmonary meds, are again called a standard risk. The high risk consists of patients who have a loss of heterozygosity, either stage 3 or 4 with a loss of heterozygosity, or stage 4, doesn't matter what loss of heterozygosity is present or no, but if they are slow responders, and all non-pulmonary metastasis. So basically what is there easy to remember is that for each stage, you go up on the risk stratification if there is a loss of heterozygosity. So a low risk stage 1 or 2 becomes a standard risk because of loss of heterozygosity, and a standard risk stage 3 becomes a high risk if there is a loss of heterozygosity. And for the pulmonary metastasis, you look at the response of the pulmonary metastasis at 6 weeks to grade them as standard risk and high risk. Based on these risk stratification, the various chemotherapy and radiotherapy have been designed. In very low risk, only surgery, no adjuvant chemotherapy or radiotherapy. In the low risk category, the surgery is there for all the patients. In the low risk category, they use the EE4A regime. I will just highlight what the EE4A regime is, and there is no flank RT. In standard risk category, there is the DD4A regime is used, and flank RT may or may not be given. We'll highlight this, where it is given and where it is not given. In the high risk category, they upgrade the chemotherapy to something which is called regime M, and they give the radiation. Again, it depends. This is the pulmonary radiation for all the patients who have a loss of heterozygosity. So what is EE4A? EE4A is two drugs, vincristine and actinomycin D, given for 19 weeks. DD4A is three drugs in which doxorubicin is added, and it is given for 25 weeks. Regime M is something which is new, in which week 1 through 6 is like DD4A. From week 7 through week 31, the basic pharma of DD4A, we have four additional courses of cyclophosphamide and etoposide. So the two new drugs that they have added is cyclophosphamide and etoposide on the format of DD4A. There's another regime, regime I, which is used, and the UH1 and UH2, which I will highlight later in the next slide, and for which tumors these regimes are used. So to summarize, for stage 1 and 2 favorable histology, we have very low risk in those children who are less than 2 years, stage 1 and less than 550 gram. If heterozygosity is not present, loss of heterozygosity is not present, they are low risk. If loss of heterozygosity is present, then they are upstage to standard risk. While in stage 3, again, the absence of loss of heterozygosity keeps them in stage 3, while loss of heterozygosity makes them high risk. In stage 4, as I said, it depends on the response of the pulmonary nodules. If there is loss of heterozygosity and they are rapid responders, they remain as a standard risk. While if there is loss of heterozygosity, but they are slow responders, or there is loss of heterozygosity present, they become high risk. And this based on this, the chemotherapy, adjuvant chemotherapy and radiotherapy is decided. Why is this important? At the end of the data presentation of the COG study from 2007 to 2013, they realized that the 5-year event-free survival improved from 72.5% of NWTS5 to 85.4% in the ARN0533 protocol. And the 4-year overall survival improved from 84.5% to 95.6%. So you look at this, that even for the stage 4 disease, pulmonary metastasis, the event-free survival overall survival is now above 90%. In the latest SIOP reports, the 5-year event-free survival has been 77% and overall 87% for the pulmonary metastatic disease. Now we look at the other, the anaplasia and some other, histologies. So they have no very low risk or low risk tumors. They have either standard risk or high risk. So focal anaplasia stage 1 to 3 and diffuse anaplasia stage 1 is called standard risk. And they are given DD4A regime with flank radiotherapy. While if the focal anaplasia is stage 4 or diffuse anaplasia is anything more than stage 1, they and rhabdoid tumors of the kidney, any stage, and clear cell sarcoma of stage 4, they received what is called revised UH1 regime. And this revised UH1 regime is basically CCE, VDC, in which cyclophosphamide, carboplatin, and leukocyte is combined with vincristine, doxorubicin, and cyclophosphamide. And they are given a higher dose of radiation, that is 2000 centigrade to the flank. While CCSK stage 1 and 3, 1, 2, 3, get something which is called regime I, which includes vincristine, doxorubicin, cyclophosphamide, and etoposide. So these are the three or four regimes which are used in the COG regime. The revised UH1 and UH2 are because in the standard UH1 and UH2, they had very, very high toxicity. And so they decrease the overall dosages of cyclophosphamide to adjust for the toxicity. Radiotherapy, I have not talked much. The local radiotherapy is 1080 grays in the flank, and pulmonary radiotherapy is 1200 grays. Whole abdomen is 1050 grays. Who gets whole abdomen radiotherapy? Patients who have had a preoperative or intraoperative rupture of tumors, diffuse peritoneal seedling seen on surgery, or if the ascitic fluid, which is new again, there's something, when we open the abdomen, we collect the ascitic fluid for cytology. If the cytology is positive, it is taken as stage 3, and these patients will get whole abdomen radiotherapy and not only flank radiotherapy. This again is slightly different in the SIO protocol, where the dose of radiotherapy is slightly more to the patients. So now we come to the SIO umbrella protocol, which is the current protocol which is being followed. In this, they have two groups of patients. Most of the patients get preoperative chemotherapy, but there are some indications like children less than 6 months of age who might be undergoing primary nephrectomy. So in this, the importance is on the histological response or what you see at histology when we operate the patient after preoperative chemotherapy. So low-risk categories are patients who have congenital mesoblastic nephroma, the CPDN, or the cystic nephroma. And if the patient has complete necrosis, 100% necrosis, which is low-risk, and as you will see later on, these patients don't get any adjuvant chemotherapy. So they have got 4 weeks of preoperative chemotherapy, but they don't get any adjuvant therapy. While the high risk, I'll go to high risk because the rest are intermediate risk. The high risk are patients who after preoperative chemotherapy show a blastemal predominance. Now for this, there is a specific definition how to say blastemal predominance, because in this more than 66% of the tumor or 2/3 of the tumor has to be viable. And of this more than 2/3, more than 35% actually has to be blastema. And then they will call blastema predominance. And blastema predominance is a term which is not there in the COG protocol because they do upfront surgery and most of the tumors are triphasic. But now COG is also realizing that if they have given preoperative chemotherapy, as in bilateral Wilms tumor, and the patient then has a lot of blastema still left, they are now upgrading the chemotherapy to regime I because the recurrence rates are higher. So the other group which is there in the high risk in the umbrella protocol are the diffuse anaplasia and the clear cell sarcomas and the rhabdoid tumors. While the intermediate risk is all in between, that is nephroblastoma regressive. What is this regressive? This is in between 66% to 90% necrosis. When there is less than this, they call it regressive. Nephroblastoma, in which epithelial stromal or mixed predominance is there after the chemotherapy, and all the focal anaplasia are put in this intermediate risk. And so this is how the umbrella protocol risk categorized. So it basically accounts for the histologic response to the preoperative chemotherapy. And this portion is lacking in SIO. We have seen in many solid tumors, this histological response to chemotherapy has come up as a very important prognostic marker. For example, osteosarcoma, in which the histological response is now being taken as a very important marker for outcome in these patients. These are the reasons why the histological subtypes were important. We look at the overall survival of these patients. The blastema predominant patients have done the worst, and the rest of the intermediate have done better. And that is why they are now put into high risk. And this is when we are comparing the blastema predominant subtype versus focal and diffuse anaplasia. So they do as badly as diffuse anaplasia, and that is why they are now being treated as high risk patients. Another thing which has come up in the SIO protocol is the tumor volume. So they have taken a 500 ml as a cutoff, and this is after the chemotherapy. When after the chemotherapy surgery is done, if the tumor volume is less than or more than 500 ml, this is how they have used it for, again, including in the risk capitalization. So in this, they exclude the stromal and the epithelial tumors, but for stage 2 or 3, which are non-stromal and non-epithelial, which means either blastoma or which has regressive type or mixed type, these tumors, if the volume is more than 500 ml, they found that the 5-year event-free survival was significantly less, 80% versus 90%. While if the the event-free survival significantly improved if doxorubicin was added to the chemotherapy. So looking at the tumor volume, they have now started adding doxorubicin to the regime which the SIO follows. So this is the umbrella protocol regime for the tumors. As I said, low-risk tumors, they for stage 1, no adjuvant chemotherapy, while for stage 2 drugs, stage 3 also 2 drugs for 27 weeks. I will not discuss a lot of this in detail because that is not a part of the talk, but here we see the importance of the risk stratification because of the tumor volume. When the volume is more than 500 ml in patients who have non-stromal and non-epithelial tumors, they've added doxorubicin to stage 2 also and stage 3 also. So in the NW2S protocol, there is no doxorubicin in stage 2 patients. While here are a number of patients who have stage 2 disease and have intermediate risk, non-stromal, non-epithelial, also get doxorubicin and flank. And so this is the difference. Well, high-risk patients, all of them get 3 drugs in stage 1 in the high-risk, depending on the histological grading, while the other protocols are HR1. Protocol, which again I will not discuss this. I have put up this slide just to show how the risk stratification is using the response of the tumor to the preoperative chemotherapy in terms of the histology and also in terms of the tumor volume reduction for these patients. Now they, as I just showed, the stage 4 dealing the metastatic disease in COG, the SIOP has a totally different way of categorizing these patients and dealing with them. I will not go into detail. It is just important for you to understand that they have a pharma which is quite complex. We have to look into the charts each time to see where the patient is falling and what kind of treatment has to be given. So they have not differentiated pulmonary metastasis vis-a-vis all the other metastasis. So any metastatic site, if it is resected at the end of the period of 6 weeks to 9 weeks and you achieve CR, they will be categorized as intermediate risk and not high risk. While all the others, if you are not able to resect it, then it is a different story. Now, this is the portion on the risk categorization. So I will halt here for a couple of minutes and see if there are any queries which people want to clarify. So this is just a gist. Actually, if you start reading into it, there are a lot of small points here and there. But this is just an overview of the risk stratification in the two protocols that we commonly follow.
Thank you very much, sir, for I think it was very helpful. One of the things which has been posted here as well, and I'll just probably expand a little bit more. So as you highlighted, a lot of loss of heterozygosity. So one of the questions which has been sent is that it's still not freely available. That's number one. Number two is, most of us take an approach which is kind of in between, as you rightly said. Most of us end up doing a biopsy first, pre-op chemotherapy, and then surgery. So we take a kind of a mixture of approaches. So how do you place that? Because you may have the biological data beforehand, although we are using, a SIOP kind of philosophy, giving pre-op chemo, but you may have the biological information beforehand. So how do you address that question?
Yeah, so as far as the biopsy goes, we don't biopsy a tumor upfront because we follow the COG. So it will upstage the patient. So if we are going to give a preoperative chemotherapy because of the reasons which I'll highlight later on, in those cases, when we give preoperative chemotherapy, we confirm the just malignancy by doing a FNAC. But SIOP does not require that also. SIOP says that any tumor within 6 months of age till 18 years of age mostly don't require biopsy,
But now they are saying that above 5 to 6 years, you should biopsy. Now, if the biopsy is done in SIOP, it was shown by the UKWT2 group that core needle biopsies do not cause any upstage and do not lead to needle tract seedlings. And the biopsies could be done upfront to achieve tumor tissue, which is naive, and for biological studies. So the loss of heterozygosity is done by the COG. I agree it is not commonly available. It is becoming more freely available. The 1P is more easily available than 16Q, but you need both. That is the problem. So it leaves a very big ethical dilemma for us also when we are managing. And suppose we have a patient who's stage 4 and the pulmonary metastasis don't respond, as I said. So they are slow responders. So it doesn't matter what the LOH, it will become high risk and we'll treat it accordingly. But if the patient, the pulmonary metastasis responds and at the end of 6 weeks, there's no pulmonary metastasis left. Now we are in a, kind of a dilemma, because if this patient is LOH negative, then he needs to be treated as intermediate risk. If this patient is LOH positive, then he goes into high risk. So the dilemma is that whether we add, because the outcome in NWTS5 was not as good, whether we treat all of them as high risk in the absence of doing a LOH study. The flip side is, what does it mean? It means that we are going to add cyclophosphamide and etoposide. Now, what is the problem in adding cyclophosphamide and etoposide? It is that it makes it much more toxic. Patients need to be admitted for chemotherapy for 5 days for this chemotherapy. And as we know, both cyclophosphamide and etoposide together will make them infertile nearly always. While the normal chemotherapy for Wilms tumor, the three drugs do not cause much decrease in fertility in the spermatogonia count later on. But cyclophosphamide and the topoisomerase 1 inhibitors will make them totally infertile. So this is a very big dilemma. So I think we need to work and get this LOH thing sorted out as soon as possible. So for some of the risk stratification, we don't know. So obviously, if we undertreat them, then we may not get as good results as has been highlighted. So I would suggest that core needle biopsies, what we have to remember is the procedure of core needle biopsies. It has to be done from the back and not from the front. We do not need to transgress the peritoneum for doing a core needle biopsy. And then it should be okay getting the tissue. And unless we get this, it is a difficult decision whether you want to upgrade the therapy or not upgrade the therapy.
Sir, as you mentioned, you're using COG strategy in your hospital. And the loss of heterozygosity is, as you said, is important parameter, especially for the very low risk and the standard risk for their risk stratification. So does that mean you have got LOH status available for all the patients, or you if it's not known, then you would just go one, just take them as positive and go one step up?
Yeah, that's what I said. The problem, very low risk, it doesn't matter. LOH is not important for very low risk. It is for the others. Now, studies, but they're like studies. So we get the result together at the end of 6 months or 8 months. It doesn't help us in managing the patient. So what we need to get done is that it should help us in managing these patients. So we have to get the results very quickly to manage these patients. So I said it's a big dilemma. I am hesitant to upgrade the chemotherapy to all the patients, because the LOH combined loss of heterozygosity is about 7 to 10%.
Yeah.
So that means we're giving 90% extra people extra chemotherapy, which is quite toxic. And it is costly, and it also needs admission, which makes it difficult for us logistically also. So I think in the next couple of months, we should be having the facility of doing it clinically, LOH, and it would help us a lot. But these parameters are not being used by the SIOP. SIOP is also studying a few of these markers. And I hope in the recent future, they will come out with their probably 17Q is being studied very aggressively by SIOP.
So there are a couple of brief questions. One is that if there is no apparent tumor rupture during surgery, but on histopathology, there is capsular breach when you submit for histopathology, will it be stage 1 or stage 3?
Capsular invasion is stage 2. It is not stage 3. So capsular invasion is stage 2 in both the protocols.
And if there's a breach, sir, if it's
capsular breach is taken as stage two only. But if there is hemorrhagic ascites, or if the ascitic fluid cytology comes out to be positive, or if there are nodules on the peritoneum when we open, then obviously it is stage three. The other confusion point is local spill versus diffuse spill. Now, any spill which takes place after you open the abdomen is taken as a diffuse spill. I will highlight this in the portion of the surgery when I talk on spills and how people have tackled this question of spill. So local spill, according to COG, is only when you've done a core needle biopsy from the back, that is taken as a local spill, stage two. In SIOP, that is also not considered to upgrade the tumor. But I've seen often that the pathologist or the radiologist have done the biopsy from the front. And then we have, child deteriorating with hemoperitoneum. That is a spill. That is a gross spill. And it is totally unacceptable if we don't want. So as a pediatric oncologist or as a pediatric surgeon, when we are taking these patients for the biopsy, the radiologist may not be aware of these nuances. So it is for us to, be very, very firm that it has to be done from the back, and using a coaxial needle will help. And we can have one track only and have multiple cores which can be taken.
Stage two blastema predominant. If it's stage two, but blastema predominance is there after you have given the pre-op chemotherapy. So the question is, does it require radiotherapy just because of the histology?
So we're talking about SIOP or we're talking about?
SIOP, sir, because you're talking about histology here.
Histology. So the blastema predominance term is in the SIOP protocol. It is not there in the COG protocol. So COG, because they do upfront surgery. But as I said, now they are thinking very hard about it. If they have given chemotherapy to any patients for any reason, preoperative chemotherapy, and then the surgery, after surgery, the histology still shows blastema, then how are they going to tackle it? So if you look at this chart of the chemotherapy of these patients, this stage, so if there is blastema after chemotherapy, it comes straight away into the high risk in the SIOP protocol, and they will treat it like high risk with three drugs and flank radiotherapy. While the patients in the COG protocol, they are still treated as stage two. I mean, it doesn't make a difference if there is blastema or no blastema. But as I said, taking a cue from the bilateral Wilms tumor, when they have given preoperative chemotherapy to all patients now, and they come up with patients who still have a lot of blastema left in the tumors, and they find a high recurrence rate in these patients, they are really trying to now think that they need to upgrade the chemotherapy to this. So here also you see, if there is, irrespective of the stage, if there is blastema type Wilms tumor, they call, they will give three drugs. And for stage one only, the radiotherapy is not given. For all others, the flank radiotherapy is given.
So I think that makes clear, sir. I think the question was predominantly stage two blastema. I think it is clear that radiotherapy is required.
Yeah.
On that. Sir, I think this capsular breach question is coming again, so I'm sorry. So the question is that if there is a breach, not just the infiltration in the capsule, but the breach, does it still not qualify for a spill? That means, does it not become stage three? So I know we're repeating.
So how does a pathologist define a breach? And yeah. I'm sure very few centers in India do this procedure, which is inking the specimen. So the surgeon is not supposed to cut open the specimen, which is a very grave error that we do. He's not supposed to bioanalyze the specimen. The specimen has to be sent to the lab as soon as possible. And what the pathologist does is ink the specimen's outside surface. After that, when they cut sections, they are able to see whether the tumor is going up to the capsule, it is going beyond the capsule. And if the capsular breach is any location, and the inking shows you that it has gone beyond, that means it has infiltrated the capsule and gone beyond the capsule. It is in both the staging procedure, it is still taken as stage two. Unless you find tumor outside. So if you find tumor in the perinephric fat or in the sinus is also stage two. So the tumor spill has to be shown to make it stage three.
Fine, sir. Riya, can you please unmute Dr. Yogesh Sareen? I think sir wanted to add something.
Sure, sir. Done, sir.
Yogesh.
Hi.
Hi.
Anything, if we can't see macroscopically the breach, that cannot be counted as intraop spill.
Breach.
As simple as that.
I agree. So there's a gross picture which they see, which you may see that probably it is breached, but microscopically it has to be confirmed that it is breached.
We can probably move ahead with the rest, with the surgical component, and then maybe more questions are coming in. We'll take them up.
Okay. So now I'll talk about surgery. So we're not talking in details about surgery, but we'll talk about the various procedures, various aspects of surgery, which both the pediatric oncologist and the surgeon need to know. So I'll touch upon these headings: the timing of surgery, the surgical approach, the technique of surgery, that is radical versus simple nephrectomy, the need for lymph node biopsy, what happens if there's spill, how to diagnose spill, vascular extension, a word about nephron sparing surgery, both in bilateral and unilateral WIMS, a word on the bilateral WIMS tumor. I will not touch upon recurrent WIMS tumor for the want of time, and just a couple of slides on post-operative management to highlight that it is important not to let the patient go, but complete the treatment fully. So timing of surgery, as I discussed again and again, and this is always a table, upfront surgery versus upfront chemotherapy, that is COG versus SIO, and it's a matter of what protocol you're following and what are the various things. And I think we should be ready to change the protocol according to the needs of our country. You know, when we are looking at a tumor which is 5 or 6 centimeters, as compared to tumors that we see, which are usually more than 15, 20 centimeters, something that we need to decide on this. When we have decided to give neoadjuvant chemotherapy, then how much neoadjuvant chemotherapy? The SIOP is very standard, 4 weeks, 2 drugs, neoadjuvant chemotherapy, except from special circumstances. But the study which SIOP had shown that 4 weeks is equal to 8 weeks was basically looking at the primary outcome measure as a spill. And we know that the reduction in tumor size does take place even after 4 weeks. So for large tumors, it may be better to go up to 8 weeks of preoperative chemotherapy. And also looking at the various staging parameters, think of adding doxorubicin. In the COG protocol, in all patients who get preoperative chemotherapy, you would be giving doxorubicin, and the patient by the 6 weeks would have got 2 doses of doxorubicin, which makes a lot of difference in the response because they are going to stage it at stage 3 and give doxorubicin anyhow in the adjuvant chemotherapy. We'll look at the response assessment for this chemotherapy and also talk about if there's any role for alternate chemotherapy, preoperative or radiotherapy also. So the goal of surgery for us is a complete removal, avoid the spill, and having a proper staging procedure done so that we can then risk stratify the patient and do. We all know that this is a very, very chemosensitive tumor, and there is no need for heroic surgery and trying to remove the tumor and at the same time trying to remove adjoining organs which may be infiltrated. So even if in the COG protocol, if they have gone in and they find the tumor adherent to the adjoining structures like the pancreas or the colon or the spleen or the liver, they would just take a biopsy and come out and give preoperative chemotherapy. That is how they work on. And they give the preoperative chemotherapy and then go in again. And example here, a large tumor which is overhanging the midline becomes a small tumor. And obviously the risk of surgery, the blood loss, the time taken for surgery, and the risk of spill, everything decreases in these patients with preoperative chemotherapy. So what is preoperative chemotherapy for the COG? For SIOP, every patient gets a preoperative chemotherapy. In the COG protocol, all bilateral tumors, WIMS tumor in solitary kidney, horseshoe kidneys where the isthmus is involved, patients with vascular extension, if the IVC thrombus is extending beyond the hepatic veins, would get preoperative chemotherapy. Here we have tweaked it a little and we would give preoperative chemotherapy to all patients with vascular thrombus, not looking at extension beyond the hepatic veins also. And the involvement of contiguous organs, which in NWTS is basically on exploration, while at AIMS, we use our clinical parameters and the CT scan to decide that this patient should get preoperative chemotherapy and not unnecessarily take up the patient for exploration and then say that it cannot be done safely and come out because of logistics also. and we think we are doing quite well with this kind of a parameter. Stage 4 disease doesn't mean that you can not take out the primary tumor upfront, but in patients who have respiratory distress, who are basically bad anesthesia risk, it is prudent to give preoperative chemotherapy and then try to take out these tumors. So these are the conditions in which the COG gives preoperative chemotherapy, and these are some of the points where we have tweaked it a little at AIMS. The CIO preoperative chemotherapy is, as I mentioned, all children between 6 months and 18 years are given preoperative chemotherapy. For children more than 5 to 6 years, they are now considering that biopsy should be done to confirm that it is not some other histology. What happens with preoperative chemotherapy? We all know it reduces the incidence of tumor rupture, intraoperative rupture. It induces downstaging to stage 1, so much so that nearly 60% of the patients in PSIOP studies have been stage 1. It selects the good responders in stage 4. So they know, and their stage 4 therapy depends upon the response to chemotherapy. So good responders and bad responders, you get to know because of preoperative chemotherapy. The same is true in COG. The pulmonary response, they have again graded as slow responders and rapid responders. The standard SIO preoperative chemotherapy is 2 drugs, vincristine and acromycin D, given for 4 weeks, which means 4 doses of vincristine and 2 doses of ACD. In stage 4, it is given for 6 weeks and it includes doxorubicin, AVD. For bilateral tumors, they give 2 drugs till NSS is feasible. Now, they reassess these patients at 6 weeks. If the response is not good in bilateral, the SIOP considers adding carboplatin and lymphocyte. They have mentioned in the protocol that they would like to avoid doxorubicin, use of doxorubicin, as compared to the COG, which uses doxorubicin quite frequently. So, SIOP would add carboplatin and etoposide at 6 weeks and reassess at 12 weeks for the resectability. We'll talk about bilateral Wilms tumor in detail a little bit later. How do we assess response? And we sometimes, when we assess response, we find that the response is not good. Now, there are various reasons for the response not being good, which I will highlight. The response assessment in COG, if you are giving preoperative chemotherapy, is done at 6 weeks. It is very important that at 6 weeks, we get the chest CT also done for those with stage 4 disease, because that is how the pulmonary responders will be found out, and the further adjuvant therapy will vary. In the SIO, after 4 weeks local therapy, their response assessment is done for the standard Wilms tumor. For metastatic disease, 6 weeks, and as I said, for bilateral at 6 and 12 weeks. So this is the response assessment, which is done by CT scan of the abdomen and chest, and also with an ultrasound and Doppler, especially if the IVC thrombus is present. So why is it important to assess response at a particular time? Because the response of the tumor will decide the timing of nephrectomy. It will also decide the role of adjuvant therapy, additional adjuvant therapy in case of metastatic disease. And it will also decide the role of various surgical procedures in cases of vascular thrombus. And here is the role, which is very important, where we have to decide who's going to do the surgery and where the surgery is going to be performed. Especially in cases with vascular thrombus, we need to decide whether we need to go into the cardiovascular OT and have a bypass standby, or it can be done in our standard OT bias only. This is the COG protocol, which tries to answer how much new adjuvant chemotherapy should be given. So as I said, they assess response at 6 weeks. If it's resectable, they would resect it. If there's moderate response, but the tumor is still deemed to be not resectable, they would give 4 to 6 weeks more of chemotherapy, reassess and reset. If the response is minimal at 6 weeks, then they would suggest doing a biopsy and looking if they're looking at something else. Now, response being minimal could be because of one of these reasons, which we know can make us think that the response is minimal, that the tumor has become totally necrotic. So a necrotic tumor is not going to decrease further in size, but we look at the CT and we say this tumor is necrotic, we should let's go and take it out. If the kidneys become hydronephrotic because of obstruction of the PUJ, and the size of the kidney that we see clinically is basically because of hydronephrosis. But then actual non-response can take place when there is stromal predominant or epithelial predominant tumors, or when there is some other histology like anaplastic tumors, clear cell sarcoma, rhabdoid tumors, or in older children, renal cell carcinoma. So these patients can actually be proven only by a biopsy. and then we need to alter the chemotherapy. So these can be the causes of non-response, both clinical and radiological, when we assess. What is the surgical approach? The gold standard approach is transperitoneal with a large incision, and the flank approach is a total no-no for these because it leads to inadequate staging of the lymph nodes and it gives an inadequate access to the IVC and the renal vein, which needs to be, you know, actually looked at during every surgery. Laparoscopy or minimally invasive surgery is coming up in a big way, but it is still experimental to be performed under surgical protocolized projects. And for tumors which are small, less than 3 centimeters in size, but the recent papers are again showing that most of the laparoscopic surgeries which are performed and recorded within the protocol have been woefully inadequate in staging. And this is something which the laparoscopic surgeons need to look at. How do they match the staging procedures, that is lymph node biopsies and looking at the vascular compartment laparoscopically. And IVC assessment is also inadequate in this laparoscopic surgery. So as I said, transperitoneal abdominal exploration. Whenever possible, we palpate the renal vein and IVC. And often, may not be often, but sometimes we do find thrombus when the preoperative scans have not shown a thrombus in the renal vein and the adjoining IVC. Radical nephrectomy and NSS I'll talk about later. It is not a routinely indicated because the gold standard procedure is still a nephrectomy and not a partial nephrectomy. Lymph node sampling has to be done properly, 7 stations as I mentioned, and the ureter is ligated as low as possible. You actually biopsy, I've already discussed the role of biopsy in these patients. So COG would biopsy a patient if it is unresectable to decide what to do further. We have to avoid, as a surgeon, we have to avoid a rupture or a spillage because any spill will then upstage the tumor, need more chemotherapy for a longer period of time, increase the cost and the complications. In the past, titanium clips were applied to help the radiotherapist, but now titanium clips are not applied. It is now only applied to areas which the surgeon feels a gross residue is being left to give a boost radiotherapy to those points. So few clips may be applied where we think that there's a gross residue being left. There are certain surgical myths and dogmas which we need to clear that for Wilms tumor, radical nephrectomy is essential. Now, this is what is mentioned in the textbooks all around. Radical nephrectomy is probably not essential, and a simple nephrectomy does as well in Wilms tumor. It is not a renal cell carcinoma, and this has been proven many times in our own surgical results, which we presented way back in 2008 in SIOP. We also showed that the simple nephrectomy is equal to a radical nephrectomy. The advantage of a simple nephrectomy is that it avoids tedious dissection from the adjoining organs, has a less blood loss, decreased risk of injury to other organs, and decreased operating time. So when we looked at our results from 2009 to 16 on 116 consecutive patients, of whom 100 have been operated by us, and it was a non-randomized study, and we looked at the radical nephrectomy and the simple nephrectomy, there was no difference, no significant difference in the tumor spill, the recurrence rate, or the overall survival, the event-free survival. We look at this these Kaplan-Meier graphs for the overall survival and event-free survival. There was no significant difference. There seems to be a little bit difference in the relapse-free survival, but it is not significant. And these were 100 patients done consequently. Then the other myth that we need to be very clear about is that lymph node biopsy is optional. It is not so. Lymph node biopsy is essential, and it was shown by Schamberger way back in early 90s that stage 1 tumors, which are labeled as stage 1, without actually having a lymph node biopsy, did badly because they were understaged and undertreated. So to label a patient as stage 1 and stage 2, you have to have an adequate lymph node biopsy, which are negative. And so lymph node biopsy is very important. The surgeon cannot say that there were no lymph nodes enlarged, so I didn't take a biopsy. Those stations have to be biopsied, whether the lymph node is enlarged or not, because it has been shown that even when the lymph nodes are not enlarged, about 20% of them will turn out to be positive. So the other surgical myth is about preoperative imaging will definitely exclude intravascular extension. This has been shown even now with a good Doppler, MRI, or good CT scan, still the surgeon is mandated to palpate and at times open the renal vein and look for a thrombus inside, which is sometimes found even when the preoperative imaging was not showing it. So the vascular extension has to be looked for in all patients. And palpation is a very important part. And sometimes we apply a clamp and open the renal vein and and look inside for a thrombus. So we talk a little bit more on the lymph node biopsy. Do we sample lymph node if not enlarged? Yes. Radiology is not good enough to show the histology. So they have to be sampled. The seven stations I mentioned are paracaval, suprahilar and infrahilar, para-aortic, suprahilar, infrahilar, both iliacs and the mesenteric. These are seven stations which have to be taken to actually have a good hang on whether the lymph nodes are involved. Lymphadenectomy has no role in Wilms tumor surgery, unlike the RCC. And enlarged lymph nodes do not need to be removed. They just need to be berry picked or sampled. And the chemotherapy and radiotherapy will take care of the rest. Tumor spill. A few words on tumor spill. According to COG, any biopsy which is done preoperative, even in SIOP, if it is an open biopsy or a wedge biopsy, it will be taken as a spill and staged to stage 3. But as I mentioned, unlike the COG, SIOP does not consider a core needle biopsy as a spill. In the COG, a core needle biopsy will make it a stage 2, while in SIOP, they don't upstage the tumor. Preoperative tumor rupture is definitely a spill, and it has to be upstaged both for chemotherapy and radiotherapy. Any spill during surgery is a diffuse spill. Once you open the peritoneum, any spill has to be taken as diffuse spill and has to be treated accordingly. Tumors which are removed in more than one piece is also called a spill. And it could be a small thing that there is an IVC thrombus. If we transect the thrombus while taking it out, it is a spill. And that is very important to know. If there is a ureteric thrombus which is hanging down the ureter, and while taking it, we have transected the tumor, it is a spill. And we have to report this and then so that the treatment can be planned accordingly. So patients who have tumors more than 15 centimeter size have a significant risk of intraoperative rupture. So these are the patients where even in COG, they would like to give preoperative chemotherapy. It was shown by D'Angio way back in 1989 that there is a 6-fold increase in local recurrence when there is a spill. The NWTS-5 study later on reported an incidence of about 20% of spill. And this led to an upstaging of the tumor just because of the spill in about 7.5% patients. The SIOP has reported an incidence of spill of around 5% because of the preoperative chemotherapy. This is a major gain for preoperative chemotherapy. And especially for us, where our tumors are very large, I think it is prudent to think of preoperative chemotherapy for most of our patients. Now, why is the risk of recurrence high? In the NWTS-4, they showed that the risk was greatest in stage 2 disease, the risk of recurrence, because these stage 2 diseases got only 2 drugs. But the risk was lower in stage 3 disease because they were treated with 3 drugs and they also got the radiotherapy. And this was substantiated by the UKWT2 study, where good tumor control rates with 3 drugs and radiotherapy in children with spill. So unlike, though they are in part of the SIOP, but UKWT group has been doing some things very differently from SIOP. And for the spills, they had given 3 drugs and radiotherapy, and so their recurrence rate was lower. And at AIMS, for a long time, we have considered all spills as diffuse spill and given 3 drugs and radiotherapy. And as I will show, that our recurrence rate were not higher than patients who did not spill. But this does not, you know, decrease the importance of spill. The surgeon must avoid a spill at all cost because it increases the intensity of therapy by addition of doxorubicin, addition of whole abdomen radiation. The treatment becomes longer, it is more costly and leads to more morbidity both in the short term and in the long run. And as I said, long-term complications may be higher. And this is the major advantage of giving preoperative chemotherapy as shown by the SIOP studies. Now, these are our results of 100 patients which we presented sometime in 2016. And these are patients, relapse-free survival of patients with spill and without spill. There was no statistical difference in these because, as I said, from the last 20-25 years, we have considered all operative spills as spill, diffuse spill, and given these patients 3 drugs and the flank radius and the whole abdomen radius. So I will discuss this vascular extension now. And the vascular extension in Wilms tumor is a thrombus, is a tumor thrombus. It is not thrombosis of the IVC, as sometimes the radiologist may point out, but it is a vascular thrombus, which is a tumor thrombus. It could be into the renal vein, into the inferior vena cava, or intracardiac, into the atrium or the ventricle, and even sometimes into the pulmonary artery. The reported prevalence as of now, the renal vein about 11%, IVC around 4 to 8%, both antegrade and retrograde, that is going towards the heart and going away from the heart, and intracardiac about 3%. The retrograde extension into hepatic veins have also been demonstrated, and which could be very difficult to tackle surgically. Why is it important to understand or diagnose vascular extension? Because it alters the management strategy. Isolated renal vein or intrahepatic IVC thrombus, according to COG, can go upfront surgery, but then there are certain problems, and there is definitely a role of preoperative chemotherapy in all these patients. What are the surgical risks of upfront resection in patients who have a vascular thrombus? The major risk is embolism during surgical handling or surgical manipulation, and this thrombus could go and occlude the outflow of the right ventricle and cause sudden death. We have had one such death long back, 20 years back. And it is a real danger, which can happen sometimes. Trying to handle this thrombus can lead to extensive hemorrhage, tumor spill because of the transection of the thrombus. As the COG staging says, that IVC thrombus, which are not infiltrating the IVC wall, are still stage 2, if they are infradiaphragmatic. And IVC thrombus infiltrating the IVC wall becomes stage 3. But if there is not infiltrating the wall and we transect the thrombus, it becomes stage 3. Anyway, incomplete excision, and the need for cardiopulmonary bypass in a large number of patients. So these are the surgical risks of upfront resection. So I think, and our experience has shown, that it is probably prudent to think of giving preoperative chemotherapy to all patients with any degree of vascular extension, as I will show with our results how it helps. So what does the preoperative chemotherapy do? It causes complete resolution of the thrombus in about 20 to 25%, where you don't need to do anything to the IVC. It decreases the need for cardiopulmonary bypass, and it decreases the surgical complications in these patients, the complications which I've already highlighted. There is a staging process for the vascular extension. It was designed by Steller in 1987 and modified by DOM. It is more commonly known as DOM's modification, though there has been an Abdullah's modification later on. So this is stage 1, 2, 3, and 4, depending upon the extent of the thrombus into the renal vein, or just less than 5 centimeters into the IVC, more than 5 centimeters going up to the hepatic veins or going into the heart. Abdullah added the involvement of the vessel wall as A, B, and C, and this is how the thrombus is segregated. The surgical technique for removal of the kidney and the thrombus will revolve around the distal extent. Distal means towards the heart, extent of the thrombus. And as I said, both in SIOP and COG, the stages stage 2 or stage 3, depending upon the involvement. So when we give preoperative chemotherapy, some of these thrombus, nearly 25%, will achieve a complete response and no cavotomy is required. The other treatment options are doing a cavotomy and removal of thrombus, or doing a cavectomy. When we do a cavectomy, remove a part of the wall of the IVC, then we may need to use a graft to repair it. Or if there is no flow through the IVC, which has been demonstrated preoperatively, we can do a total cavectomy. And still nothing will happen to the patient, because there are other veins which have developed to take care. And at times, cardiopulmonary bypass and atriotomy is required to remove the thrombus, which may be in addition to the cavotomy which is required. So it becomes a really extensive and messy procedure, and also costly, because if you are going to the cardiac OT, it does increase the cost and the risk to the patient. So in our, if you look at the AIMS results for vascular thrombus from 1999 to 2017, we had a prevalence of around 7.3%. 28 of the 382 patients had a thrombus. 17 of these were non-metastatic disease, while 11 were metastatic disease. Why it is important, I'll highlight in a couple of slides, that 40% of our patients with vascular thrombus were actually stage 4 disease. So of these 28 patients, preoperative chemotherapy was given to 26. And as you can see here, complete response of thrombus was seen in 23% of these patients. The rest of them needed some surgical procedure to remove the thrombus, which included cavotomy and cavectomy, and at times cardiopulmonary bypass. And only about 10 to 11% of the patients actually needed cardiopulmonary bypass. This is an example of a patient who had a thrombus which was more than 5 centimeters into the IVC with infiltration of the IVC wall, but good flow, which means we had to do a cavotomy, extraction of the thrombus, and may need a cavotomy and pericardial patch repair. We did this in the cardiac OT. I'll not waste time in showing these photos, but here is the IVC opened with the thrombus being removed and then repaired. Part of the wall had to be removed because it's infiltrated. We used a pericardial graft to repair this IVC wall. What are the results? Though it is mentioned in the literature that the vascular thrombus does not make a difference in the outcome of these patients as compared to patients without vascular thrombus, but this has not been our experience. The overall survival of these patients has been lower than the other patients without a thrombus, and the event-free survival has been lower. And this is mainly because of the stage of the disease, which I will just show in the next slide. As I said, 40% of our patients had metastatic disease. Of the non-metastatic 60% patients, all of them had a disease, long-term disease-free survival. While in the metastatic patients, we had recurrences and we had deaths because of recurrences and progression. And this is where the result makes a difference. If you look at these Kaplan-Meier survival functions, the overall survival and the event-free survival for patients who had metastatic disease is significantly lower than patients who had non-metastatic disease. So this is a straightaway pointer for us when we're looking at vascular involvement in these patients. And it really decreases our output, our outcome, because nearly 40% of metastatic represent. Now, a few words on nephron-sparing surgery and surgical myths and dogmas. Partial nephrectomy for all WIMS tumor is the way forward. I don't think it is the way forward, because I'll just say, tell them various things why nephron-sparing surgery has come into picture, especially for unilateral standard WIMS tumor. So it is a plea for all the pediatric oncologists that this aspect should not be discussed with the parents, because it will depend on a lot of things which the surgeon has to decide, whether nephron-sparing surgery should be done or not done. Because once you give this option to the parents that you may be able to save a part of the kidney for a standard unilateral WIMS tumor, it is something which becomes at times very difficult to convince the parents that actually the patient needs a nephrectomy and that is the best for the patient. So it is something which has to be discussed between the surgeon and the pediatric oncologist and not with the parents. So nephron sparing surgery. So it has come from the success in bilateral WIMS tumor and the concept of hyperfiltration injury, which leads to glomerulosclerosis, proteinuria, and detected as microalbuminuria. And it was thought that because of this, the contralateral kidney undergoes damage slowly, and which leads to a decrease in GFR and may lead to end-stage renal disease in this patient. What has been more recently shown by Kozi et al. Is that it is not only the end-stage renal disease, but the decrease in glomerular filtration rate overall increases the risk of cardiovascular events, which means the MIs and the strokes, which increases after 40 years of age in the patients who have had complete nephrectomy on one side. So this is the data from NWTS 1 to 4. Of the 5,823 patients, 55 patients developed renal failure, which is less than 1%. 39 of these 55 patients were actually bilateral WIMS tumor, 24 of them having had bilateral nephrectomies done. Only 16 patients were unilateral WIMS tumor, which is less than 0.25%. And most of these patients of unilateral WIMS tumor were syndromic with Denys-Strauss syndrome, Wegener syndrome, and other GU anomalies. So now the debate is on non-syndromic standard unilateral WIMS tumor, whether nephron-sparing surgery is the way forward or not. So the cumulative risk of renal failure at 16 years for bilateral synchronous WIMS tumor is around 9%, and for metachronous is around 20%. The risk is higher in unilateral WIMS tumor with these syndromes like Denys-Strauss, Wegener, and other GU anomalies. And in these, as I will highlight, there are relative indications for doing there are very strict criteria in which one can try nephron-sparing surgery. It has to be a stage 1 tumor. It has to be polar. involvement of hilum or lymph nodes should not be there, which basically means frozen section. It has to be favorable histology. If it comes out as anaplastic, we have to go back in and remove the tumor. There has to be no intravascular extension and at least 1/3 of the parenchyma. In the past, it was said 2/3 of the parenchyma. Now it is 1/2 to 1/3 of the parenchyma should be preserved if you are considering a nephron sparing surgery in these patients. There are other various criteria of the tumor volume being less than 300 ml and the size being less than a particular size that the nephron sparing surgery should be attempted. So it is a debatable topic and it is still not considered as a standard of care, nephron sparing surgery in unilateral Wilms tumor, but both the protocols do not discourage it. They say you can go ahead and do it in a protocolized manner, but maintain the data so that we can see later what happens. Absolute indications for nephron sparing surgery, relative and elective indications. As we all know, bilateral Wilms tumor and Wilms tumor in a solitary kidney is definitely an absolute indications. Sometimes the solitary kidney may mean that the other kidney is involved with like multicystic dysplastic kidney or is non-functional because of QJ obstruction. So basically in this, you are left with no choice but have to do a nephron sparing surgery. Then relative indications. So coexisting urological abnormalities, which we know that increases the risk of end-stage renal disease are conditions like Denny-Strash, Wegener, and tuberous sclerosis. In these, we must consider and try to do a nephron sparing surgery. There are other conditions which actually increases the risk of metachronous Wilms tumor, like NRIDIA, hemiapetrophy, Beckwith Windman syndrome, and the presence of nephrogenic rest or nephroblastomatosis. So in these also, it is a very strong relative indication for trying to do nephron sparing surgery and saving the kidney. Elective indications are definitely conditions like cystic nephroma or CPDN, where the whole kidney is not involved and polar involvement is there. You can safely do a nephron sparing surgery in this. The debate, as I said, is always non-syndromic unilateral Wilms tumor. What is the problem? Now, even mild dysfunction, that is a GFR of 60 to 90 ml per minute, is considered as a risk factor. The meta-analysis which was done showed that the GFR of less than 90 ml per minute increased the risk of both major vascular events and death at 20 years and more so at 70 years. So where this data come? There are two studies by the same group, Posi et al. So in the first study, they showed that post-operatively, there was a significantly higher EGFR in patients who had undergone nephron sparing surgery as compared to a unilateral nephrectomy. But look at the numbers. He's deriving this data, which is played upon everywhere and talked about by everybody, in which there were only 10 patients who had undergone NSS and total number of 25 patients. So when thousands of patients of Wilms tumor are involved and you're talking about 10 patients and trying to, you know, project this data over and over again, saying that nephron sparing surgery is the way to go, it's something that we have to think about. The second study was a cross-sectional longitudinal study of renal function. Again, there were 60 radical nephrectomies, 12 nephron sparing surgeries, and they were evaluated after 40 years of age. So out of 12 NSS, only one had an EGFR of less than 90. So again, saying that because the EGFR falls in these patients who do not have a nephron sparing surgery, one must do nephron sparing surgery, which is, I think, something which we need to think, because there are many, many more. So then I think the sample size is too small to say this, what is being said. So what is the bottom line? COG is considering it as investigational, maintained data. If you want to do it in a protocolized manner, in a study protocol. SIAP also says that the protocol does not recommend, but one can go ahead and do nephron sparing surgery in non-syndromic unilateral Wilms tumor, but do it in a study protocol and collect the data. So I will not discuss about the surgical options because there are many surgical options for nephron sparing surgery. Some are better, some are not as good. We'll go on to the next aspect, that is the bilateral Wilms tumor. Now, the incidence of synchronous is around 5%, metachronous around 1%, and the outcome of bilateral Wilms tumor in NWTS-5, where there were 158 bilateral Wilms tumor, the four-year event-free survival was 61%, overall survival 80%. Now, the first line which they write in the outcome is the outcome is nearly as good as unilateral Wilms tumor, but that is not true. we see here both in PSIOP and in COG, the outcomes have been poorer than the standard unilateral Wilms tumor. 90% of the relapses in bilateral Wilms tumor takes place within the 4 years, and 90% of the deaths take place within 6 years. 9% to 10% of these develop end-stage renal disease because of various reasons in this. So there has been a debate about requirement of initial biopsies, whether open biopsy or core needle biopsy. But the bottom line today is that initial biopsy is not required because it does not help. So biopsy is only done for non-responders. That is at 6 weeks or 8 weeks, biopsy is done. And preoperative chemotherapy is the way to go for all patients, with followed by delayed surgery in patients. In the COG, the preoperative chemotherapy includes 3 drugs, which includes doxorubicin. While in the PSIOP, as I said earlier, 2 drugs, actinomycin and vincristine, till the resection is feasible. The response assessment in both the protocols is at 6 weeks, and there they change. At 6 weeks, if the response is not good, the PSIOP adds carboplatin and etoposide, while the COG suggests that think of doing a biopsy and looking at the histology of these patients. Now, poor response in bilateral Wilms tumor, again, as I said, could be because of extensive necrosis. NWTS 5 study has shown that nearly 22% of the patients who had poor response, there was extensive, nearly 100% necrosis. The presence of mature elements, which is not uncommon in bilateral Wilms tumor, like rhabdomyomatous elements, stromal elements, and epithelial elements, may also be the reason for poor response. And then, obviously, other unfavorable histologies. In NWTS 4 data, out of the 188 patients, 158, this is wrongly written, 158 patients of bilateral Wilms tumor, 27 had diffuse anaplasia, which is quite a high number. So that is why importance of biopsy in these patients. When there is no response, biopsy upfront does not help, because even if you take an open wedge biopsy, sampling error will not actually help you to diagnose dysplasia in most of these patients. So non-response to preoperative chemotherapy, as I said, COG 3 drugs with doxorubicin from the beginning, and they have shown much less relapse rates, 8% versus 43%, where doxorubicin is not used. While in the PSIOP umbrella protocol, they only add carboplatin and etoposide, and they want to avoid doxorubicin. And this is added after 6 to 7 weeks when the response has been very poor. But both the protocols are very clear that the surgery should not be delayed beyond 12 weeks. There is no role of preoperative radiotherapy, no role of other high regimes to be used, because the most common cause of non-response, as I have mentioned, is either necrosis or the presence of mature stromal elements in these tumors, and sometimes different histology. So we have to be careful for adding other chemotherapy in these patients. A word upon the post-operative management, which is very important, especially when the surgeons are taking care of it. I mean the surgeons and not the pediatric surgeons. There are a lot of urologists and general surgeons doing this, and they treat it like renal cell carcinoma and don't send the patient for adjuvant therapy, and that is why they come with a lot of recurrences in these patients. So when to start the chemotherapy post-operatively? As soon as the ileus subsides. The timing for radiotherapy, which is subscribed, is not later than 14 days, but it's difficult to get this. It's difficult to get a radiotherapy slot within this period. More importantly, especially at AIIMS, it's difficult to even get the histology within 14 days. The timing of reassessment postoperatively is also important. 12 weeks following surgery, the radiological reassessment should be done. As we all know, the recurrences are more common within the year of diagnosis. That is, a lot of recurrences take place during the therapy or immediately after the therapy ends. This. And also, we should be aware of the timing of metastatectomy, which I'm not going to discuss today, which is varied in COG and PSIOP protocol. And there are various protocols for looking at the metastatectomy in this. So to conclude this surgical portion, I think the surgical steps are fairly standardized, and people are requested to look at these standardized protocols and follow the steps. And where the pediatric oncologist is referring to a pediatric surgeon who is not regularly doing Wilms tumor surgery, I think it is mandatory for the oncologist to discuss with the surgeon so that he's made aware of the steps that he needs to do. We should follow the protocol in all the cases. Whatever protocol you fix for yourself, follow it. Otherwise, we'll not know where we are going. We should mention all the standard steps in the operative notes or the referral note, and specially mention about the spill and other deviations from the protocol, because then only the proper staging can be done. If operative spill has not been mentioned, the pathologist may call it a stage one tumor, and then you will understage and undertreat and have a recurrence at your hands. There's no way to find out a spill operatively under the surgeon reports this. So that ends my talk, and I have still got about 15 minutes to take some questions.
So thank you very much, sir. I think it was very elaborate, and I'm really sorry for having this longest session. You have been speaking for the last almost 1.5 year, a half hour, and it's fantastic. I would say overview of these two important aspects. So there are a few questions. I know there'll be lots of questions, but I'll just at least take a few which have been asked. So one question is on the infiltration on the tumor thrombus, sir. Infiltration of the vessel wall versus no infiltration. So is that an operative finding always, or you can get some clue on the imaging? So that's one, sir. And the second is that if there is a suspicion of infiltration, which makes the surgery a little complicated, which you already highlighted, is there a role of extending the neoadjuvant chemotherapy in those cases?
So in this, it's clear that when the NWTS, the American people were doing upfront surgery for the vena cava thrombus, there were far less infiltration of the IVC wall. When we give chemotherapy to these patients, there is a strong inflammatory reaction to the thrombus, and the thrombus adheres to the wall and infiltrates the wall. It's a histological diagnosis or an operative diagnosis. When we cannot slide out the thrombus from the vena cava, it is adherent and infiltrating the wall. And if we resect a part of the wall, then histology can confirm it. Often it is very sad because the thrombus itself has no viable tumor. It's all fibrotic, but then it is infiltrating the wall. And all these patients will be staged as stage three, will get three drugs, and will get local radiotherapy also to take care of recurrences.
Thank you, sir. So the other question is on bilateral realms. When you do a nephron sparing, so what would be the surgical conditions or prerequisites to have adequate renal spared, nephron spared post surgery? Because we still see sometimes quite advanced bilateral renal. So how do we approach them, and what would be the minimum kind of normal functioning nephrons?
Right. So if you look at the older recommendations, the NWTS would recommend that do a nephron sparing surgery on the smaller tumor and do a nephrectomy on the other side. But gradually people realize that this leads to end-stage renal disease. So now the recommendation is, as far as possible, try to do NSS on both the sides, even when the tumor is very large. And it doesn't matter. So as I said, there are various techniques of doing NSS. The most important and the best technique is a partial nephrectomy, where you go through a normal renal parenchyma. So for this, you need to have the tumor as a polar tumor, and you can go just a few millimeters away from the tumor and do a partial nephrectomy in the normal parenchyma. That is often not possible in the Indian scenario, where the tumors are very large and there's hardly any parenchyma to go through. So in these patients, we do what is known as enucleation. We go around the pseudocapsule of the tumor, knowing very well that the recurrence rate in enucleation is slightly higher than partial nephrectomy, because it's not a capsule that Wilms tumor has, it's a pseudocapsule. And there are small fringes of tumor which penetrate the pseudocapsule into the surrounding tissue. And that is why recurrence can be there if chemotherapy does not take care of it. But we have to do this, because in the Indian scenario, for the parents to accept renal transplantation as an option is very difficult for them for us to convince them. So we have to make all efforts to save as many nephrons as possible, and which we have highlighted in our paper, which was published in Indian Journal of Pediatrics some 3 or 4 years back. That we land up with some recurrences, which is slightly higher than the international. But when you have multi-site tumors, or you have tumors which are so large, there is nothing but we have to try to do. Sometimes it's a surprise that the larger tumor size with hardly any renal tissue actually comes out to be better functioning kidney later on, because we do a renal dynamic scan in all these patients in the follow-up to see the function and the drainage in these patients.
Thank you, sir. So there was also a question, because most of us are medical oncologists, pediatric oncologists. So there was a question on simple nephrectomy versus radical nephrectomy. Dr. Sareen has replied that the differences between the two. I think that's probably clear. The other question which was posted in the chat box was, sir, on the ureteric extension of the tumor. So, you know, extension can be sometimes quite lower down as well. So how do you approach with a ureteric extension?
The ureteric extension could be a free hanging extension, not infiltrating the wall. Again, a free hanging extension is a stage 2 tumor in COG. While if it is infiltrating the pelvic wall or the ureteric wall, it becomes stage 3. We have also seen tumors hanging down from the ureter into the bladder. Now, in the past, if you look at 1970s and 80s, any patient who presented with hematuria would undergo a cystoscopy to look at the ureteric orifice and if the tumor was present there. And as the tumor was seen protruding from the ureteric orifice, the surgery recommended at that point of time was doing a nephrectomy and taking a cuff of the urinary bladder also to remove the tumor. That is not recommended now. You remove the tumor. If the tumor is extending into the bladder, then we would open the bladder and remove the tumor from the bladder also, but not necessarily to take a cuff of the, because the chemotherapy and the radiotherapy takes care of it. So that is about the ureteric thrombus.
Sir, you know, some of the bilaterals, you know, who, you know, even after nephron sparing may end up in an end stage renal disease, or the you know, nephron sparing is not possible. And, you know, if their option of renal transplant is there, so what timing would you suggest post completion of treatment to undergo a renal transplant? 1 year, 2 years?
Okay, the standard recommendation is 2 years disease free. So after completion of chemotherapy, these patients are put on hemodialysis. 2 years after completion of chemotherapy, if the patient is still disease-free, then he becomes a transplant candidate. But these recommendations are changing more and more as people are realizing that putting a patient on hemodialysis, especially a small child for a longer period of time, actually causes a lot of morbidity. So I hope these recommendations will come down. But then you are also looking at the availability of the donor kidney and the wastage of a donor kidney. If the patient develops a recurrence, because you've done it too early, and then it's a sad thing to do. So still the recommendation is 2 years.
So thank you very much, sir. I think we have covered most of the things which were asked and posted here. If anyone else has got anything else to say or comment or ask anything else, you know, please feel free to ask, raise your hand and we can unmute you. Any other questions? I suppose there are none, because it was such exhaustive, and I think you have covered probably all the doubts, especially from the surgical aspects which we have. It was an excellent overview. Thank you very much again for your time and spending this evening with us. And we'll hopefully have you soon with some of the aspects of surgical aspects of pediatric oncology in the next few weeks to months to come. So thank you very much, sir, for your time. And thank you, Ria. Thank you, Echo, for the platform, for hosting this session for our students.
Thank you for having me. And thank you for having invited the members of the Surgical Oncology chapter.
Well, I think there are two more questions.
Pediatric surgeons. I hope some of them would have listened to. Thank you very much.
Good evening, sir. Good evening.
It was a pleasure for me.